हेलो लर्नर्स, आई एम डॉक्टर सुबोध किशरवानी वर्किंग विद इंदिरा गांधी नेशनल ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी इन स्कूल ऑफ मैनेजमेंट स्टडीज़। आई एम टुडे द टॉपिक विच आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक इज़ ऑन अ वेरी कंटेम्प्रेरी टॉपिक, दैट इज़ ग्राफिकल रिप्रेजेंटेशन। वी हैव अ वेरी सीरीज ऑफ डिस्कशन रिलेटेड टू डेटा एंड हाउ द डेटा इज़ गोइंग टू यू नो रिप्रेजेंट इन द टेक्स्ट फॉर्मैट। नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक समथिंग मोर ओवर एंड अबव टू दैट विच टॉक्स अबाउट दैट हाउ वी आर गोइंग टू रिप्रेजेंट द डेटा इन अ डायग्रामेटिकल मैनर। So when we are going to present a data in a visual manner, I think there are two ways by which we can do the presentation, that is the diagrammatical presentation and the graphical presentation. So already we have a very very elaborative session which talks about, you know, the diagrammatical presentation, where we have talked about, you know, the pie chart, the bar chart, one dimensional, two dimensional, and lot of, you know, varieties of ways by which, you know, the data is going to be presented in a diagrammatical manner. So this is one of the sequel to that, and here we are going to talk more about, you know, the graphical presentation of data, which is quite meticulous as far as the research is concerned, as far as the statistics is concerned. So anyway, before going into the depth of this topic, I just want to throw a light what exactly the research methodology and statistical analysis is. You know, this is part of our MCOM program, and this is a second year course, and exclusively talks about, you know, the methodology and the statistical analysis which we are going to use, because in today's scenario research and statistics is a very contemporary term, because with the help of this, you know, you can able to visualize many things. So already we have covered somewhere around 13 to 14 lectures. If you recapitulate yourself, you will find out we have a very elaborative sessions on research, we have a very elaborative sessions on data collection, sample measurement of screening techniques. Because why I am, you know, just recapitulating in every session about my preceding terms, because when you talk about the research, when you talk about the statistics, there is a great use of all these terms. It's not like that we have used the term at one step and you know, we are not going to get the reference of that. But when you are going to the depth of you know, recapitulating yourself or using the statistics, I think these terms are quite burgeoning in nature and have a, you know, good presence when you are using in as far as the methodology is concerned, as far as the analysis is concerned. So anyway, we have already covered the first block, which was focusing on the research and data collection, and the second block is more talking about, you know, the processing of data and how you're going to preserve the data. So while, you know, preserving the data or, you know, the process of data, there are certain modus operandi which we have to follow, and this diagrammatic presentation is one of the important ingredients which we have already covered and talk about how you're going to present the data in a visual format. So already we have a very innovative sessions, very thought provoking sessions, and now we are just focusing on the graphic presentation of data. This is if we go more into the depth of this graphical representation, I think graphical representation of data is nothing but a chart in which data is represented by symbols such as bars in bar chart, lines in line chart, or slices in pie chart. So in our preceding session, we have seen that how the diagrammatic presentation is governed when we are going to talk about all those aspects, and these are, you know, converted into one dimensional, two dimensional, or three dimensional. So anyway, a data chart is a type of diagram or graph that organizes and represents a set of numerical or qualitative data. We have already talked about quantitative data and qualitative data. So this data chart is type of diagram or graph that organizes and represents a set of numerical or qualitative data. So in our preceding session, we have talked about bars, circles, rectangles, squares, and certain maps also, like flow charts and other thing. But here we are just concentrating on a different kind of diagram. So if you see this particular chapter, you know, which is known as Unit 7, and the heading of the chapter is Diagrammatic and Graphical Representation, which starts with, you know, the diagrammatic presentation, and the first, you know, the ingredient of this is rules for preparing diagrams that we have already talked about. And there are certain types of diagrams, you know, one dimensional bar diagrams known as simple bar diagram, multiple bar diagram, and subdivided bar diagrams. So already we have talked about it, pie diagrams, and then structure diagrams like, you know, the organizational chart or flow chart. The example which we have quoted about, you know, the certain organizations which have a hierarchy of people starting from, you know, top level, middle level, and lower level. How this hierarchy is going to be, you know, depict when we are talking in terms of chart. So this organizational chart is very important. Then we have a flow chart. So flow chart is working as a decision tree, where you try to do certain things, for if you do that, yes is there, and if you know, you move on to the different So certain options are going on. So anyway, we have covered all those things. Now we are just concentrating on graphical presentation, and this graphical presentation is the innovative way of presenting the thing. It could be in the form of OJAI, in the form of histogram, or you know, the frequency polygons, or you know, other ways that we are going to talk about in a coming slides. And then we have graphs of time series, which talks about graphs of one dependent variable and graphs of more than one dependent variable. So this is a very important ingredient, because as far as you know, the graphs of time series is concerned, it is just focusing on graphs of one dependent variable and graphs of more than one dependent variable. Then you have graphs of frequency distribution, where histogram, frequency polygon and cumulative frequencies curves are taken care. So anyway, we start with our discussion, and we know that you know, the visual presentation have a great impact, and if you talk in a present scenario, I think we are moving one step ahead to that. And we are not only you know, visualizing the presentation, but also animated in the video format. So this is one of the new ways which are coming in the present circumstances, and this is going to bring a niche in the statistics world or in the research methodology world. So we have discussed about one of the techniques of visual presentation of data, that is diagrammatic presentation, and we appreciate that how such presentation eliminates the dullness of data, because when you talk about you know, the data analysis in a vis-a-vis you know, the text manner, I think somewhere you know, the dullness is there, the monotony is there. So when you are talking in terms of presentation in a visual manner, it's more interesting and helps in comparison between two or more frequency distributions. So this is something which is going to play a very important role, because the role of the frequency comes in between. Now we will study another important technique, and which is known as graphical presentation. And if we take example of this graphical presentation, I think stock index, cricket score, production trends, that is in various magazines or in televisions, we have observed that things are going on. And right now, you know, there are certain blogs and statistical, you know, the annual reports which are floating on the website can also be the example of that. So everybody, irrespective of whether he or she is a layman or an expert, has a natural fascination for appropriate graphical presentation of data, which remains an essential part of research methodology. I have already quoted about that. The graphical presentation of data leaves an impact on the mind of the readers. That is very true, because when you float certain things through text, I think there are certain monotony and gigantic shape of data. I think it's really cumbersome for the individual to you know, extract the information from the text. So when you make a graph, when you make a pie chart, bar chart, or you know, the graphical representation, I think somewhere you know, your presentation part is quite good. So this graphical representation encompasses a wide variety of techniques that are used to clarify, interpret and analyze data by plotting points and drawing line segments, surfaces and other geometric forms of symbols. We are going to you know, talk about all those things, and the purpose of the graph is rapid visualization of data. That is very true. A choice among graphic techniques also depends on the proposed use to which the chart will be put into it. So these are the you know, the graphical presentation which is omnipresent in the present scenario, that is Lorentz curve, histogram, frequency polygon, frequency curve and OJAI. So and all these you know, comes under the ambit of called the graphs of time series. Why we are quoting the time series? Because time series is a set of values of a variable or variables arranged over a period of time. So that is the reason you know, we have used the heading called graphs of time series, and there are certain examples related to that, the data relating to the production, sales expenditure, exports during the last 10 years, and the graph of time series is prepared to show the values of one or more than one variables over a period of time. So this type of graphs are also termed as a time graphs or histograms, because history is represented graphically. So that is the reason you know, the time series, when we talk about the time series, we talk about the past records and the past history. So 10 years down the line, we prepare any chart. So histograms is known as is one of the examples to that, and these graphs are helpful in studying the changes over a period of time and forecasting. So on the basis of the past record and the present trend, we forecast. So this is the beauty of histograms, and can be constructed in two ways: on a natural scale, that is arithmetic scale, and on a ratio scale. So in natural scale, you know, the graph reflects the changes in absolute values over a period of time, whereas a ratio scale graph reflects the relative changes over a period of time. So In this presentation, however, we study the histograms on natural scale, which is generally used in business research, because as far as our paper is concerned, this research methodology paper is for the Masters of Commerce student, and there is a great use of, you know, how the business trend is changing and how certain new trends are coming up. So this histogram is going to play a very vital role when you are going to work on the time series manner. So now the question is come that when to use a histogram. So we are going to use the histogram when the data are numerical, that is very true, and a lot of mathematics are involved, and you want to see the shape of the data distribution, especially when determining whether the output of process is distributed approximately normally, that is required, and analyzing whether a process can meet the customer requirements. So that is more important, you know, if the customer requirement or, you know, the respondent's requirement is not going to fulfill, I think your analyzing process is not going to work out. So whatever you are going to analyze is you know, based on the output for a supplier process looks like, and whether a process change has occurred from one period to another period, that also need to be required. If there could not be any change in the preceding years or in the present years, I think then there could not be any comparative view. So determining whether the output or two or more processes are different. So what I mean to say, we have to communicate the distribution of data quickly and easily to others. So that is the reason, you know, there are certain statistical analysis which need to talk about all those aspects. So when you are going to talk about the graph of one dependent variable, when there is only one dependent variable, the values of the dependent variable are taken on y-axis while the time is taken on x-axis. So we will see how the, you know, this statement is going to be interpreted with the help of certain, you know, the figures which we are going to explain. We will study the certain examples and try to understand the methods of construction for one dependent variable histogram. So there is another term called false baseline. So false baseline is a device relating to graphical presentation. This line is used to break the continuity of y-axis with the origin. And false baseline is used when figures start with high values. If we maintain continuity of the value from the origin, then sufficient portion of the graphs would go waste. So what we have observed that this false baseline is working as a device and is related to the graphical presentation. And this graphs of frequency distribution, if we talk about, you know, we have seen in our preceding lecture or in the presentation that frequency distribution are, you know, explained with the help of tables, and these frequency distribution can also be presented in the forms of graphs. And that is, you know, the beauty of, because when you talk about the frequency distribution, I think the data size is quite high, and such graphs can give a better understanding and provide illustrative information to readers than the data in tabular form. So when you have a data in tabulated format, I think the data size is quite high. You have multiple rows, multiple columns, and you're not going to interpret what best can be done. But if that same table, you know, can be governed with the help of certain charts or certain graphs, I think very easily you can interpret what exactly you are expecting from that particular image. So it is true that effective graphs can markedly increase a reader's comprehension of complex data sets. And when you compare with the table, graphs of frequency distribution are helpful in identifying the characteristics and relationship of the data. And this relationship is more important that how the trend is going to change. If we take a you know, the chart of 5 to 10 years down the line, very easily we can interpret that what could be the future of that. So these graphs are useful in locating the position averages such as mode, median and qualities, etc., which we have already covered in measure of center tendency. We have seen that in measure of center tendency how this mean, median and mode is going to be taken care. So in a continuous frequency distribution, there is a class limit, mid values are taken on y-axis or on x-axis, and the frequency on the y-axis. So the vertical axis, which we usually call the y-axis, is not broken, thus the false baseline cannot be taken. So a frequency distribution, if we talk about, can be portrayed by means of histogram, frequency polygon, agile curve and scattered diagram. So these scattered diagrams, which we are going to take with the help of certain examples in our coming sessions, and you will find out that there is a great use of scattered diagram. But here we are going to start with certain, you know, the graphical presentations, and histogram is one of that, and it's part of the time series. And histogram is an approximate representation of the distribution of numerical data. It was first introduced by Carl Pearson, and these frequency distributions shows how often each different value in set of data occurs. And histogram is the most commonly used graph to show frequency distributions. We will take certain examples we see that how it is quite important. It's look very much like a bar chart, but there are important difference between them, because when we talk about the bar chart, there's a gap between two bars. But when you talk about the histograms, histograms are you know, linked with one another, the bars are attached with one another without any gap. So when we will take certain examples, we will see how important it is. So histogram meaning can be stated as a graphical representation that condenses a data series into an easy interpretation of numerical data by grouping them into logical ranges of different heights, which are also known as bins. And a histogram is used to display continuous data in a categorical form. So this is a USP of this histogram. And if we talk about how to create a histogram, that is something, because there are certain parameters which one has to follow. And if we go more into the depth of it, you will find out that how the things are going to be calculated. So if we are going to create a histogram, I think to construct a histogram, the first step is to bin or bucket the range of values, that is divide the entire range of values into a series of intervals, and then count how many values fall in each interval. The bins are usually specified as consecutive non-overlapping intervals of a variable. So we have seen that, you know, for 2, you know, the 2 is the score and the frequency is 3. 3 is the score, frequency is 7. 4 is the score, frequency is 2. So 6 is the score, frequency is 5. So this is the, in this manner, you know, we have plotted the histograms, and you see what is the impression behind that you know, the initially we are gradually we are going up, then going down, then after certain time then again go up and then go down. So this is the model. So there are certain facts and figures related to histogram. Now the question is that is histogram is a qualitative or quantitative? Pie charts and bar diagrams are used for qualitative data. That is very true, we have already seen that. And histograms similar to bar graphs are used to for the quantitative data. Line graphs are used for qualitative data, scatter graphs are used for quantitative data. So if we talk about, you know, this bar chart and pie chart, they are more qualitative in nature, where histogram is more quantitative in nature. So how to interpret the shape of the statistical data in a histogram? We have seen that, you know, the symmetric is there, then skewed right is there, and when we go more into depth of symmetric, I think the histogram is a symmetric. If you cut it down the middle, in the left hand and right hand side resemble mirror image of each other, that is very true. And skewed right histogram looks like a lopsided mound with a tail going off to the right. So there are certain examples of the skewed left also. So what does the shape of a histogram tell us? So it's a bimodal. We have already talked about, you know, in mode, when we are going for the mode, we have seen that how the bimodal and multimodal works. So bimodal shape shown below has two peaks. If this shape occurs, the two sources should be separated and analyzed separately. And this is the manner, and some histograms will show a skewed distribution to the right as shown in below. And what we have seen that, you know, if you see this particular image, you will find out that how the histograms arrivals are there. The frequency is at one axis and arrivals at different, and then we have plotted the histograms. So now this is another way of explaining the histogram, the distribution of randomly generated numbers, where we have seen that how the histogram is going to create it. But the good part of the histogram is that all the bars are attached with one another. There is no gap between the two bars, whereas in bar chart you will find out that there is a gap between the two. So this is the difference between the histograms and bar chart, and you see that how the gaps, no gaps are there, whereas, you know, in bar chart you will find out the gaps are there. So anyway, now we are going to talk about another types of graphical presentation, that is frequency polygon. And when you go more into depth of polygon, I think it's many angle diagrams. So this is another way of depicting a frequency distribution graphically. It facilitates comparison of two or more frequency distributions. So frequency polygon can be drawn either from the histogram or from the given data directly. So you have got varieties of way, and if you see this particular image, you will find out that histogram is this and frequency polygon is this. That in the same, in first we have plotted the histogram, and gradually after plotting the histogram we have taken the midpoint of each bars and then plot a frequency polygon. So this bar is nothing but a histogram which is attached with one another, whereas on the whereas frequency polygon is just the midpoint of that bar and dot is the representation, and gradually we have seen that how we have plotted this. So what we keen to say that when we talk about the cumulative frequency curves, sometimes we are interested in knowing how many families are there in a city, or we can take certain examples whose earnings are less than 20,000 per month or whose earnings are more than 30,000 per month. So in order to obtain this information, we have first of all to convert the ordinary frequency table into a cumulative frequencies. When cumulative frequency is going to be added, with the help of certain numbers which can be added. So if in the table we have got two ways and frequency is general, so cumulative frequency is the addition of the existing one and the preceding one. So we add, we get the cumulative. So next would be added of that. So when the frequencies are added, they are called cumulative frequencies, and the curves so obtained from the cumulative frequencies are called cumulative frequency curves, popularly known as ogives. So there are two types of ogives. We are going to talk about in a more elaborative manner. And if you see this, so these ogives are start with the upper limit of each class, and the cumulative starts from the top. So when these frequencies are plotted, we get less than ogive. So they are less than ogive and they are more than ogive. So, and if you go more into depth of the ogive, these ogives are useful to determine the number of items above or below a given value. It is also useful for comparison between two or more frequency distributions, and to determine certain values like the positional values such as mode, median, quartile, percentile, etc. Because we have seen that when you talk about the measure of center tendency, this mode, median are seems to be the positional values, because with the help of there is no impact of the outliers. And when you talk about the mode, the number which repeated maximum number of times, we have already have a very elaborative session on measure of center tendency, which are considered to be the mode, and medium is the middle number. So what we have observed that an ogive, sometimes called a cumulative frequency polygon, is a type of frequency polygon that shows cumulative frequencies. So in other words, the cumulative percents are added on the graph from the left to right, and ogive graph plots cumulative frequencies on the y-axis and class boundaries along the x-axis. So the ogive for the normal distribution resembles one side of an arabesque or ogival arc, which is likely the origin of its name. So if you see this particular image, you will find out that how we have plotted the ogive, and this is the manner the ogives are going to be developed in particular image. So there are certain differentiation between less than and more than ogive. So in this ogive, the frequencies are added starting from the upper limit of the first class interval of the frequency distribution, and in this ogive, the cumulative total tends is going to be in a increased mode. And when you are going to talk about the more elaborative manner about the less than ogive, the plots, the points with the upper limits of the class as abscissa and the corresponding less than cumulative frequencies as ordinates. So these points are joined by freehand smooth curve to give less than cumulative frequency curve or the less than the ogive. So this is example of less than ogive, and when you go and talk more about the more than type ogive, it is a graph drawn from lower limits and cumulative frequencies of a distribution. And when we are going to mark the points with the lower limit and x coordinate and corresponding cumulative frequency and y coordinate, and then when we are going to join them by freehand smooth curve, this type of graph is cumulated as downward. So what we have observed that this ogive is also quite important, and the time when we are making a graphical presentation, this histograms and ogive is very important. But on the other hand, the Lorentz curve is also one of the way of graphical representation of income equality or wealth equality, and this was developed by the American economist called Max Lorentz in 1905, and the graph plots percentile of the population on the horizontal axis according to the income of wealth. So what we have seen from this particular image that we bifurcate this whole rectangular box, and from the mid, from point zero, and then this considered to be the line of equality, and Lorentz curve supposed to be move in that way. So this red line is considered to be the Lorentz curve. And if you talk more about the Lorentz curve is a graphical method used to display the concentration of activities within an area. Example given, the degree of industrial specialization within an urban area, Fieldwork data may be used, but it is more common to use secondary source. And the technique is particularly useful as it provides a good visual comparison of any observed difference and from its precise index, which Gini coefficient can be calculated. So the further away Lorentz curve is from the line of perfect equality, which is diagonal, we have seen that the more diverse is the sample and the more unevenly the values are spread out. So this is useful to estimate how wealth is distributed among a population. So if a country's Lorentz curve is distant from the line of perfect equality, it means a small percentage of the population controls most of the wealth, and that country income distribution is uneven. I think we have talked a lot about graphical representation, and we have seen that how there is a difference between the diagrammatical presentation and graphical representation. So this is one of the important ingredient as far as the presentation of data is concerned, and one of the important component of the block 2, which talks about how you are going to process the data, because we know that the data is quite gigantic in nature and it's really cumbersome for the researchers to accumulate the data or get the results out from that data, because if the respondents have reciprocates and they have given the information in a tabulated format, so it's really tough for the researchers to go for that. So in that case, if they use this statistical phenomena or the way of presenting the data, I think this is somewhere where they can get the depict the things in a very faster mode. So graphical presentation is very important ingredient, and as far as this particular block is concerned, which more emphasize on processing and preservation of data, this graphical presentation, diagrammatical presentation and processing of data is important ingredient, because the first block, the very first block consists of somewhere around 10 to 12 lectures and was focusing on how you're going to do the research, do the analysis and collect the data. But now this second block is more emphasizing on preservation of data, because if you preserve the data and interpret the results, I think somewhere you can able to move in a more systematic manner. So we have some more sessions which talk something related to processing and preservation of data in our forthcoming session. Thank you very much.